In the headlines, three persons are in police custody as the probe continues into the brutal murder of two Burmese teenagers. The president has directed the police force to use all tools available to bring the perpetrators to justice.
This is not about race and religion or political things. I'm talking about my own behalf. This is not about all these things for me. But this is for justice because of my son's innocent life.
A $330 billion budget is to be announced on Wednesday, with COVID-19 support for every household, the reintroduction of the cash grant to every single public school student, an increase in the old age pension, and a raft of tax relief measures for individuals and key sectors. And in sport, President Ali announces a multi-purpose sports complex for Regions 2, 6, and 10. With the news, I'm Neil Marks. We're glad you could join us. We begin with the brutal murders of Burmese teenagers Joel and Isaiah Henry. The mutilated bodies of the boys, aged 18 and 16, were found by villagers on Sunday at Cottontree, West Coast, Burmese. The boys lived a few villages away at number 3, and that entire community has been plunged into mourning, and residents have bandied together to demand justice. The parents of Joel and Isaiah are now left with only memories of how the youngsters filled their lives with happiness. Even as extreme measures are being taken to demand justice by a full and thorough police investigation, the boys are remembered by both relatives and villagers for their fascinating youthfulness. The community has received the support of the coalition opposition in their protest actions, with commitments to fund the burial of the boys. The newsroom's Kurt Campbell visited the area today.
We're bringing you coverage from Number 5 Village here on the west coast of Burmese, where residents from Number 5 Village itself, the Number 4 Village and the Number 3 Village, have joined with two families to protest the gruesome murder of two teenage cousins at the weekend. Residents have regarded that crime as a hate crime fueled by race and is calling on the Guyana Police Force to carry out a thorough investigation and ensure that justice is served in relation to what has happened. We have members from the Major Crimes Unit currently on the ground here in the backlands where the two teenage boys were discovered on Sunday, carrying out their investigation and gathering evidence. We've seen on the ground here this morning former President David Granger and opposition leader Joseph Harmon visiting the area, engaging with residents and speaking to the family. We've had several commitments coming from the two gentlemen. Mr. Granger told the residents and the protesters that their reaction to what has happened is a correct response. He has endorsed what is happening here. Mr. Harmon has also endorsed what is happening here. And we've got commitments from them that the APNU AFC coalition opposition will stand the cause for the burial of the two young men. Let's take a look at what Mr. Granger and Mr. Harmon had to say this morning.
It is not your fault, it is not the boy's fault. Mr. Harmon, the leader of the opposition, has promised to ensure that there's a thorough police investigation. But what is clear now from all the people from West Coast Burmese, it's Region 5, Aika Burmese, is that whatever happens on this day, we have to establish some self-defense society to protect our children, protect our women and our young people. Because unless we protect ourselves, nobody's going to protect us. What you all are doing here is the correct response to a crime. And the government must protect all citizens, whoever they are, wherever they are, day and night. It is not happening, it's not happening. And if the government does not do its duty to protect our citizens, we must protect ourselves.
We will take the opportunity to assist with the burial expenses. Yeah. We will take care of the burial expenses. Thank
you. The former president and the opposition leader were also joined by other members of the APNU AFC coalition. We had former Minister of Education Nicolette Henry here with them this morning. Nicolette Henry is believed to be a cousin of the two teen boys that died. We've also seen several other parliamentarians of the APNU AFC opposition on the ground here this morning. The newsroom was also able to speak to the mother of Joel, one of the guys that died, Ms. Gail Johnson. Ms. Gail Johnson fought through tears to remember the type of person her son was and also recounted her last moments with him. Let's take a look.
wait, I'm stressed out. I can't explain my feelings. I'm very, like, discouraged, you know. I'm sad. My son was a very loving person. Very loving. Caring. He always calls me to try to help me. The same morning he leaves to go to work. And then I keep sitting waiting on him and knows it is a well even down with a friend. That was the last day.
We also spoke to the father of Isaiah, one of the teen boys that was killed, Mr. Henry. Mr. Henry also recounted his last moments with his son. He has also called on the Guyana Police Force to carry out a thorough investigation and to ensure that justice is served.
You saw that brutal torture. I know that my son and my cousin, they hollered them as he begged them as he pleaded. I don't know why they didn't see these little boys that could have asked them where they come from. There is not number five boys, or you know, people get grievance about number five people and that kind of things. This is not about race and religion or political things. I'm talking about my own behalf. This is not about all these things for me. But this is for justice because of my son's innocent life that go in the background. They could have considered these two youth, young youth. They could have considered these people, these youth get family. They could have considered they get friend, maybe girlfriend or boyfriend, girlfriend, maybe people that could have responded. They could have beaten them or injured them, carry them. You know, punish them, carry them at the station. There is the right thing I should have done. Grew up in church. I taught them the ways of the Lord. In Sunday school right down to this age. And he was a very nice and quiet boy. Friends in this family. In this village we know, my nickname is Jira because all of the black, all of the Indian used to live between. And me being a black, they said the Jira in the dark. My son and I take up the fields, the same son that dies, take up the same footstep and moving around with all Indian by becoming this community. Indian and black is one.
Heavy police presence on the ground here this morning. We also have members from the Guyana Fire Service here on the ground. And we have residents holding placards and showing demonstration that they are against what has happened and they're calling for justice to be served. Currently, there is a backup of traffic. No vehicle is allowed to go into the deeper into the Burbage region, to the Burbage Bridge, and vehicles are not allowed to go to traverse into the city. But the police is here, the police is keeping things under control, but residents have taken to the streets. They have blocked those streets using tires and other debris, and they are calling on the Guyana Police Force to carry out their investigation and ensure that the matter is resolved and justice is served. Reporting for the newsroom from Burbage, I'm Kurt Campbell.
President Irfan Ali has directed the security forces to ensure the perpetrators are brought to justice swiftly. The murders have seen residents blocking roads and burning debris in calling for justice.
Fellow Guyanese, this morning I had the unfortunate task of speaking with the father of Isaiah, Mr. Gladstone, and the mother of Joel. It is unfortunate because of the tragic way in which these young men met their death. On behalf of the people of Guyana, and on my own behalf, and that of my family and government, I express our condolences to the family, to the parents, and I assure them that as president, I would work very, very hard to ensure those criminals are brought to justice. And as a society, as a country, we have to heal and we have to work on strengthening our relationships. We have to work on ensuring that crimes like these and criminality like this does not reoccur. I assured the parents, the relatives, of our commitment in ensuring justice is served. And more importantly, I want to ask all Guyanese not to use this moment to divide us or to separate us, but for us to be conscious of the implications that our statements, comments, and posts can have, especially on social media. I can tell you, the parents of these two young men are sincere. They are humble people. And as they go through this moment of loss, as they grieve in these moments, the communities from which these young men came from, what we can do as a people, as a country, as Guyanese, is to strengthen our resolve, strengthen our commitment, strengthen our sense of purpose to our communities, to our neighbors, to our friends, to each other.
On Monday morning, the Minister of Home Affairs, Robson Ban, said the police have been required to conduct a professional probe to bring the perpetrators to justice.
I first off would like to reiterate what I have put down in a statement with respect to the extremely unfortunate and vicious event which occurred on the west coast of Barbies, resulting in the deaths and the mutilation of Isaiah and Joel Henry. Whatever may have been the reason for it, insofar as we know or may surmise, there could be no excuse for what happened, for the deaths of the young men and the egregious mutilation of their bodies. We share the shock and hurt and horror at this event. We are surprised at the extremities of the results which accompanied the event, and we want to reassure the public and to reassure all Guyanese that no effort will be spared to bring the perpetrators of this heinous crime to justice. The Guyana Police Force has been very active already on the ground in respect of their investigations relating to this matter. The Guyana Police Force is required to do a professional investigation and to bring calm and order to the area of West Coast Barbies.
As we have reported, those arrested so far in the brutal murder of the Barbies teens, Joel and Isaiah Henry, are the owner of the farm where the boys' mutilated bodies were found. The owner's son and a handyman are the others who have been held. The Commissioner of Police, Nigel Hoppe, briefed the media on the investigations Monday morning.
First of all, permit me please express my condolences to the relatives of both Joel and Isaiah Henry. And as iterated by the minister, a gruesome act was committed on these two individuals. They were pretty young and what we call shut out in the prime of their youth. But to be specific,
recording is on.
It occurred about 15:30 hours on Sunday, September the 6th, 2020. The bodies of both Joel, 18 years old, and his cousin Isaiah Henry, 16 years old, 16 years old, of number 3 village, West Coast Barbies, were found but discovered bearing several marks of violence in the village of Cotton Tree, West Coast Barbies. The victims had left their home during the morning of Saturday, September the 5th, 2020, for the Babdam to pick coconuts. They did not return home as expected, and consequently, a missing persons report was made by relatives of the police at Blairmont Police Station. And that was done on Saturday evening. A search party was formed on Sunday.
Recording has stopped.
Which led to the subsequent discovery of the bodies that are presently at the Anthony's funeral home, awaiting post-mortem examination. The police have since launched an intensive investigation into this gruesome murder, and information so far has led to the arrest of 3 persons who are in police custody assisting with investigation. In the meanwhile, the angry residents have blocked the road, and as iterated by the minister again, we're appealing for calm in that area and are urging residents to allow for the free flow of traffic along the roadways. I wish to assure you that the Guyana Police Force would conduct a thorough investigation into this matter and ensure you also that no stones should be left unturned in addressing this, as we would do it from a professional standpoint as always.
When the newsroom returns, the government to present a $330 billion budget Wednesday and a raft of relief and tax measures are announced. You're watching the newsroom. Vice President Bara Jagdeo on Monday announced that the 2020 emergency budget is estimated at $330 billion, some 10% more than 2019. However, he said much of the budget represents money already gone in a spending spree by the last government and also takes into account annual payments. With the spending already and other costs, the new PPP government was only left with $22 billion for new initiatives. It also includes $7 billion for COVID-19 relief. The budget will also include a $5 billion subvention for the Guyana Sugar Corporation.
The total budget is about $330 billion. This represents an increase of about $29 billion over 2019, which is a 9.6% over 2019. Now, you would think that, well, we are in September now, why this big budget? Well, a substantial part of this money has been spent already by APNO. So, of the $330 billion, $72 billion is for capital expenditure. And if you take out the foreign funded capital expenditure, it leaves $49 billion of local expenditure that is in the budget. But of this $49 billion, $27 has already been spent based on rollover from 2019, when they went on, APNU went on a spending spree with money it didn't have, that was not approved in the budget, when it gave out illegally large numbers of contracts in 2019. So that rollover plus releases of money on the capital side, which is downright illegal because there was no budget for 2020, yet the government released money. And just a tiny part of it was for COVID. The bulk of it was for other things. So when you combine the two, unauthorized basically spending, that's $27 billion of the $49 billion in this year's budget has already been spent as of July 31st, that is before the PPP got into office. So really, we only had room in this budget from local expenditure to program $22 billion for new initiatives.
President Irfan Ali announced the removal of VAT, the reversal of VAT in some cases, and the removal of corporate tax in other cases. These will be included in the 2020 budget to be read on Wednesday. There will be the reversal of VAT on electricity and water, and pensioners will not have to pay for water. There will be the removal of VAT and duties on machinery and equipment to allow for recapitalization of key sectors, namely mining, forestry, agriculture, and manufacturing. Because of representation from the sector, there will be tax concessions on ATV for mining, forestry, agriculture, and manufacturing. There will be reversal of land lease fees for the poultry sector. This increased by over 1,000% over the last 5 years. The president also announced reversal of VAT on fertilizers, agrochemicals, pesticides, and key inputs in the poultry industry. There will be a reversal of VAT on all exports and the removal of VAT on hinterland travel. The VAT on all medical supplies will also be removed. There will be removal of VAT on building and construction materials. A removal of VAT on cell phones was also announced. The president announced the removal of corporate tax on private education and private health care. Any license renewed after October 2020 onwards will be reduced by 50%. To stimulate logging, the export logging policy will be changed to allow sawmillers to export logs. There will be a reversal of the policy to allow for importation of used tires and allow for importation of vehicles more than 8 years old. There will be the removal of the requirement to register and take out road licenses for mining equipment. Further, there will be a removal of the requirement for miners to secure police clearance to transport fuel in their own vehicles. Now, President Ali also announced a range of relief measures for Guyanese as the country continues to battle COVID-19. He said every household will benefit from $25,000. For frontline workers, $150 million has been set aside, but the details of how this will be disbursed were not immediately announced. The president also announced that the joint services, the Army, Police, Fire and Prison Services, will benefit from a two-week bonus on their salaries for this year. The president made the announcement during a press conference. Vice President Bharat Jagdeo explained how the program is being rolled out.
We've had numerous challenges how to get the money to people as swiftly as possible, because they've had a system where people should register online, but many people in the rural areas, the hinterland, even in Georgetown and places, can't go and register online. They don't have access to Wi-Fi, etc. Then we were concerned that if we give the money to the NDCs alone, then maybe you'd have a lack of accountability. And one of the reasons why we decided more to move away from targeted approach, because we know if it's $25,000 per household, some wealthier families will get the money too. We're hoping they don't take it. But if you had only sent out teams to go and say, you decide which household, it could be done in an arbitrary fashion and often with discrimination. And, you know, all sorts of issues come into play. So the easiest way is to say each household must be a beneficiary. Now, each house. So what if an extensive form has been developed that has the name of the recipients, the ID card, etc., particulars. They're going to go out, the teams are going out with a voucher. They would probably be attired with PPEs and stuff. Go to the home with a voucher, hopefully with a card of vouchers. They will be given like vouchers with sequential numbers. The vouchers hopefully will be by regions, so it's hard to duplicate. And they would have to account for each voucher. And then on each form, they would have go to every home and say, you're eligible for one voucher. So the person, they would put the number of the voucher and the form ID, they would countersign the form and the voucher, two or three persons there with the household. hopefully that will be the most accountable way, and then they have to come back in and account for it. Now, there may be in some households more than one
in some houses more than one households,
but they would have to now fill up those forms and come and make a case for those. Because if we allow the people going out to give out 10 in a household, then everybody may want to take, you know, you can have corruption too. But if it's one per household, at least initially, and you get the bulk of the money into people's hands or the vouchers into their hands, then we can always come back and deal with the houses where you have multiple households. So that is what we're hoping to put in place, that you can get it out in a transparent way.
And the auditor general part of it.
Yes, and all of this has to be audited. All of it has to be, there'll be a unit that would have to present to the auditor general.
Meanwhile, President Ali announced a range of measures for the education sector, including restoring the education cash grants to thousands of school children. The cash grants will move from 10,000 that it was before 2015 to 15,000 from this January. The grant is given to every child who attends school in the public system. Further, the uniform grant will be doubled. The corporate tax for private education is also being removed. $200 million was also set aside to expand the Guyana Learning Channel. The president was moved also on Monday to defend the work of his government over the past month since he was sworn in to fight COVID-19. The efforts include acquiring a new machine which can run 900 tests per day and fixing the facility at Liliendale East Coast, Amararo.
I remember from 2 days before I was sworn in, the numbers climbed. We are testing almost 500% more than what we were testing before. We have hundreds of people turning up to be tested now that never took the opportunity to be tested. We were testing between 40 to 60 per day. We are testing some days 250 now. So if we are doing more tests, if we are more aggressive in reaching out to the people in doing the testing, then you expect that there will be a correlation. You expect that there will be a correlation. And in addressing that correlation, we have to address many issues. We have to address care. We have to address facilities and infrastructure. And we have to address the critical need, the ICU. Between the short time we're in government, we have 29 new ventilators already in country. 16 more is coming. 40,000 new test kits. All that the last government did was to spend billions of dollars on the ocean, on the Liliendale facility that cannot be used. There is no oxygen in there. There is no water in there. There is no electricity in there. There is no sewer system in there. We have fixed all of that in this month. We have fixed all of that in this month. Additionally, we are addressing economic and social consequences of COVID-19. As president, I've spoken to the government of Russia. I've spoken to the president of Brazil. Today at 6, I'm speaking to the president of Argentina. I've spoken to leaders in Latin America. I've spoken at CARICOM heads of government meeting. And all of it were conversations related directly to COVID-19. What can be done? What resources are available? We've reprogrammed $60 million for COVID directly. My discussion has been advanced to the stage now that I'm trying to put Guyana on the top priority for the vaccine when it comes. So that we don't have to wait until next August. It's aggressively addressing the issue. These are the things that we are doing. These are the things that we're working on. We have just invested in a new COVID-19 a PCR machine that will do 900 tests per day. We have trained 30 new technicians to work in the lab. So when you ask what we are doing, this is what we are doing.
As negotiations continue between ExxonMobil and the government to get the best deal for the third development project called Payara, Vice President Bara Jagdeo said this is not the final opportunity to get the best oil deal. The Payara development plan includes a floating production, storage and offloading vessel named Prosperity. It is expected to produce 220,000 barrels per day. It is projected to start up as early as 2023, but that timeline depends on early approval of the development plan. The government has put in place a consultant team to review the plan.
The last thing I wish to do is to telegraph our position in the negotiations. Yeah. There is an ongoing negotiation between Exxon and the government of Guyana over issues that we do not see eye to eye on. In the Payara license, we have differences, and I do not want to telegraph what may be our final position. But let me just say generically that we don't favor flaring. We're opposed to flaring. And secondly, that we believe that any water discharge, whether reinjected or discharged, must be treated to international standards. That is in the two matters that you asked me about, but these are generic positions. We see this as a continuum. Exxon is not going to disappear tomorrow. Payara license is not the only opportunity that we have to get what the president said we wanted and what the People's Progressive Party campaigned on, which is an industry that benefits the investor but significantly benefits Guyanese, our people, through jobs, business opportunities, etc. So there are numerous opportunities in this continuum. This is not a one event activity where Payara will determine all of our relationship or determine all of our negotiating positions or opportunities, because there will be one when we come to talk about local content and local content legislation. There'd be another negotiating opportunity when we talk about gas and the development of our gas fields and the price for gas and how much of it comes on shore and how it will benefit our people. We have to talk also about training opportunities. We made that clear that Exxon has to do more for training of Guyanese. We have to aggressively pursue costs of the company, because so far they have not audited a cent or completed the audit of a cent of the costs, even pre-production costs. The exploration costs up to 2017 and costs up to 2017 and now being audited. So there are large opportunities for us to agree or disagree with costs. We see some areas where we don't believe that expenditures that are made now or are part of cost oil should be part of cost oil. So I don't see this, and the government does not see this, as Payara is the make or break. It's important that we get investments too. You know the international climate. I saw even in the newspapers them saying about even Exxon's global position, how it has diminished. So investment dollars are scarce out there, but that we're not cowed or threatened by that. So the negotiations will proceed on these matters. We'll move to protect the interests of the country.
More news ahead. Stay with us. You're watching The Newsroom. First Lady Arya Ali last weekend made good on her commitment to support local group Seawalls and Beyond as they endeavor to clean up the seawalls.
At 8 a.m., First Lady Arya Ali made her way to the famous seawall bandstand, where she was greeted by members of the local group and volunteers who had commenced cleaning some 2 hours earlier. Dwayne Hackett, the group's coordinator, took the First Lady and Solid Waste Director Walter Narine on a mini tour of the area, showing them the work that was done and some of the challenges which will need to be addressed if the area is to be transformed into a tourist hub. The First Lady had met with the group at her official residence state house and gave her commitment to support the group's work. The First Lady said the efforts of the group complement her national beautification project, which brings to the fore scenic conservation aimed at safeguarding the scenic qualities of Guyana's roadways, urban spaces and countryside.
I would love to see many of this, many groups like this coming out and cleaning up and beautifying our country, if not just Georgetown, our country as a whole.
The occupation of the area by vagrants, improper lighting, unregulated vending, and the absence of washroom facilities and a freshwater source are some challenges Seawalls and Beyond had highlighted.
Seawalls and Beyond, the group of about 40 to 50 volunteers at the moment, we understand environmental cleanliness and the beautification can only be achieved and maintained if all stakeholders are involved. Both citizens on one hand, as well as state authorities and agencies on the other. We all must do our part.
One of the pillars of the National Beautification Project focuses on regulation and monitoring of any form of unlawful intrusion on the landscape or community appearance of public spaces. The Seawalls and Beyond group has a number of recommendations for the authorities.
To the relevant authorities and agencies such as central government, local governments, and all relevant state agencies to A, launch and maintain a countrywide public education and awareness campaign on solid waste management issues. B, ensure that waste disposal and collection systems are adequate and functioning efficiently. C, actively pursue the establishment of recycling facilities in Guyana, especially for plastic. D, build strong relationships with the private sector with the aim of solving waste management and environmental issues and hold them accountable. And E, enforce the anti-littering and anti-pollution laws that are already in existence.
While the removal of waste at this time is being done by volunteers, the First Lady noted that maintenance will be important, as so she has committed to engaging the relevant authorities to ensure that the area is properly maintained. The First Lady has also indicated that part of her restoration plans for the seawall will be the planting of trees along the coastline and the reintroduction of the creative arts at famous bandstand. After cleaning, the First Lady made a donation of cleaning and other supplies which she was able to mobilize through the private sector. Some of the supplies included pitchforks, spades, buckets and brooms. It was a commitment she made to the members of the Seawalls and Beyond earlier in the week after the group submitted a list of items it was in need of. The items were donated by National Hardware, Gafours, Caribbean International Distributors Inc. and Cellphone Shack. Bibi Katun reporting for the newsroom.
Agriculture Minister Zulfikar Mustafa at the weekend visited the Skeldon and Rosehall estates in Region 6 to assess their conditions. There, the minister disclosed that the former estate managers were assigned to various estates to determine what are needed to reopen them.
We have also visited the two estates, which we plan to, we have made a commitment, the PVP Civic, we have made a commitment to reopen these estates. We have visited both estates, Skeldon and Rosehall. And we have set up a team there. The teams are headed by Mr. Vishnu Pandey and Mr. Aaron Dukia. And they are looking now at a plan of action, what has to be done to bring this estate back in our operations. So I am very optimistic within a week or two I should receive that plan from them so I can advise Cabinet on what is there or what are, is the need in those areas.
The Minister of Amerindian Affairs, Pauline Sukai, has said that there are big plans for indigenous communities to be funded from the 2020 budget, which will be unveiled on Wednesday. Details in this report.
Minister of Amerindian Affairs, Pauline Sukai, distributed 40 food hampers and other items to vulnerable families in the community of Fairview Village in Region 9. At a community engagement at the Fairview Primary School, Minister Sukai explained that the initiative is part of the government's effort to bring relief to citizens who have been affected by the COVID-19 pandemic. This, the minister said, will complement the stimulus grant announced by President Irfan Ali.
I will tell you today what commitments We had stepped the seed before the end of the year realized. Our government promised that we will increase presidential grants to villages. And we expect to see that increased presidential grant will be allowed to be delivered to the villages. So that's one of the commitments that we make to our indigenous brothers and sisters in their villages. You will see that you will get an increased presidential grant. But this means that we have 3 months to access those grants. All right? So I will encourage you, Fairview, and all the other villages across the hinterland to send in their proposal like now.
Minister Sukai also used the opportunity to update the villages on some of the projects to be included in the budget 2020 for Amerindians.
I want to assure you that our government is also going to reintroduce the CSOs. Remember the CSO program? Well, that program will be reintroduced on the first 20 villages that prepare themselves to access support from this program will be done before the end of 2020.
As it relates to the presidential grant, Minister Sukai advised the 115 villages slated to benefit to immediately prepare to submit proposals for their respective projects so that the funds can be disbursed by the end of December this year. Minister Sukai said the first phase of the CSO program will see an initial 20 villages benefiting. The remaining villages will be targeted in 2021. Similarly, 25 villages will be targeted this year for the ICT program, which will see the villages accessing funds to construct information communication technology hubs, which will be equipped with computers and other internet connections. Pibikatun, Newsroom.
That's it from me, Neil Marks. The Financial Weather and Bridge Reports, along with Sport with Avinash Ramzan, is up next.
Welcome back to Newsroom. Avinash Ramzan here with tonight's sport. We start things off by telling you that sport development in Guyana is set to receive a massive boost with the construction of 3 multi-purpose sport facilities. The announcement was made on Monday by President Irfan Ali. According to the president, the facilities would be built in regions 2, 6, and 10. He said the facilities are aimed at supporting the growth and development of young people, the country's sportsmen and women, and unearthing new talents. The president was at the time highlighting measures in the emergency budget to be presented on Wednesday. The 2020 emergency budget is estimated at 330 billion Guyana dollars. Now, 5-time losing finalists, the Guyana Amazon Warriors are looking to book another spot in the championship game of Hero CPL, while the St. Lucia Zooks are aiming for a maiden trip to the grand finale. The two sides clash in semi-final number 2 on Tuesday afternoon from 17:30. Akim Green previews the contest.
Barton has underperformed as compared to previous editions of the CPL, with this season just one batsman, Glenn Phillips, surpassing 200 runs after the 10 preliminary matches. Though both Warriors and Zooks have quality and match-winning spinners in their arsenal, Warriors captain Chris Green said on Monday, the definitive factor in the match will be who bats best. Only 2 batsmen from both sides have accumulated 200 runs or more this season.
Look, I think spin for all teams have been playing a key part in obviously keeping the runs down and taking wickets. Imran Tahir, you know, the wickets and numbers and quality of leg spinner speaks for itself, and he's been key to our success. And similarly, St. Lucia playing a number of off spinners and as well as the Chinaman and the Javel Gling, it's probably been a revelation for them. So it will be a bit of spin versus spin, but I think it's going to come down to the batting. The guys who can get in there, build a partnership, put their hands up and deliver a big score, or help the team get a big score and help us defend it or chase down whatever's set for us.
Greenford indicated the team is focused on the task at hand and are conscious of their previous shortcomings in the knockout stages. He said they are confident since he felt they are peaking at the right time and they are taking it one step at a time. Warriors have won their last 4 matches quite convincingly after the Dodgers start to the season. Barbados Tridents had a similar season in 2019, where they too finished second on a point standing after preliminary rounds and went on to title success.
I think a lot of teams have done it from this situation, but knowing at the same time the other three teams left in this competition aren't just going to roll over and give us this competition. We spoke about learning along the way. We spoke about peaking at the right time and sticking together and showing good character. And I think that's been a key part of our success. And, you know, it's taking this tournament and one day at a time. And, you know, our focus today is on training. Our focus tomorrow will be on St. Lucia, and we're not looking too far past that.
This is only the second time in 8 seasons since Zooks have reached knockout stage, the first being in 2016. And according to the skipper, Darren Sammy, they are under no added pressure to perform.
Our first objective is to get to the playoffs. And now we are here. Our focus is on the Amazon Warriors, you know, and we are planning how to come up with ways in which we could defeat them. We've done that once before in this competition, and we believe we could do it again.
With both sides banking on their spinners, the preferred option might be to bowl first given issues of the Jew at the Brian Lara Cricket Academy. The Guyana Amazon Warriors playing 11 will come from Chris Green, captain, Imran Tahir, Nicholas Puran, Brandon King, Ross Taylor, Sherman Hetmeyer, Kisun Dat Magram, Kimo Paul, Shafin Rutherford, Romario Shepherd, Naveen Al-Haq, Chandra Paul Hemraj, Kevin Sinclair, Ashmit Ned, Udin Smith, Anthony Bramble, and Jasdeep Singh. This is Lucia Zook squad reads Darren Sammy, captain, Rawson Chase, Mohamed Nabi, Andre Fletcher, Najbullah Zadram, Keswick Williams, Scott Kugler, Chimar Hula, Obed McCoy, Rakim Cornwall, Mark Dial, Zeril Khan, Kimani Milius, Enuka Boucher, Kavim Hodge, Javil Glenn, and Sadman Zafar. For the newsroom, Hakim Green.
And the red-hot Trinbago Knight Riders, fresh off an unbeaten run in the league stages of Euro CPL 2020, will put their record on the line against an inconsistent Jamaica Tallowers in the opening semi-final. The game will bowl off at 10 hours. Hakim Green reports.
TKR 2 wins away from a 4th title and an unbeatable record of 12 successive wins in one season of the CPL. Current form suggests they will likely topple Tallowers, who have lost their last 3 matches. But history put both sides even after 18 previous encounters. TKR's head coach, Brendan McCullum, is back on his side to go all the way, but is guarded against complacency.
It's been a really good season so far from us. The guys have played some exceptional cricket, and to be sitting here on the eve of the semi-final and we're 10 from 10 is a magnificent effort, I think, particularly because the conditions have been so extreme. You expect some results to sway a little bit, but the way that the guys have gone about their work has been second to none, and certainly can't fault them from that. It doesn't guarantee us ultimate success, but I know that in tomorrow's game in particular, I know we'll play well. Doesn't mean that we're going to be standing there victorious at the end, but I know that the work that we've put in to this point will mean that we're going to play a good game of cricket tomorrow, and hopefully that's good enough to get the result.
On the other hand, Rafan Powell, Tallowers skipper, related his side are confident despite the mixed result this season. Tallowers have only won 3 matches of their 10.
A lot of character in the team and a lot of persons who want to be that guy on a big day, and that is important when it comes to a semi-final. You know, a lot of things haven't gone well, but since, even though things haven't gone according to plan, we have a lot of performers in the team and we're definitely looking forward to tomorrow's game.
Trinbago Knight Riders squad reads Kyron Pollard, captain, Dwayne Bravo, Sulin Ryan, Colin Monroe, Fawad Ahmed, Darren Bravo, Lendell Simmons, Kari Pierre, Tim Siriford, Shikanda Raza, Anderson Phillip, Pervin Tambe, Jaden Seals, Amir Django, Tion Webster, Akil Hussein, and Mohamed Ali Khan. The Jamaica Tallowers squad reads Rovman Powell, captain, Andrew Russell, Sandeep Lamachani, Carlos Bradwitt, Glenn Phillips, Chadwick Walton, O'Shane Thomas, Asif Ali, Fidel Edwards, Preston McSween, Jermaine Blackwood, Nicholas Curtin, Ramal Lewis, Nkrumah Bonner, Rosario Pomol, and Ryan Prasad. For the newsroom, back in green.
And St. Kitts and Nevis Patriots skipper Riyad Emrit has described the 2020 CPL as miserable for the franchise. The Patriots, who entered the tournament with much promise, flattered to deceive, finishing at the bottom of the table, winning just 1 of their 10 games. Emrit reflected on their performance after a final loss to Knight Riders at the weekend.
if there was one thing that you could have changed in your campaign this year, what will that be?
Getting our entire team here. it's been a tough road, entire tournament. Our batters just didn't turn up in the entire tournament. And, you know, we have no excuses now. It's been a miserable tournament for most of us. And it's just for us to learn. I guess we didn't learn quickly throughout the tournament. And, you know, we played the best team in the tournament today. And we see why they're number one and why we are last.
You're exceptional with the ball throughout the campaign. 11 wickets to you. How do you view that in the context of what your team has achieved?
Gangs, it's good to be, you know, 11 wickets at the end of the tournament. It's good. It's something that I work hard for and I continue to work hard. But, you know, it's difficult to digest where we ended up in the tournament. You know, I think I am a decent leader enough not to finish last. And, you know, I've tried everything that I have, all the resources behind me. And it's a tough pill to swallow, you know, to come last. And, you know, I'm not going to hear the end of it. You know, my teammates and TKR are going to pressure me every day. And it's, you know, they... talk is going to be relentless, so I just have to go back and try to learn. There's a lot of things that I still have to learn as a leader. Hopefully I can do that and, you know, come back strong.
Well, that loss has been tempered with so many challenges you face as a team. There must have been positives that you can take forward into the next campaign for the Patriots.
Yeah, there's a lot of good youngsters in the team. You know, Joshua showed the bits and pieces what he's capable of. Young Archibald is sorry that he didn't get the longer run in tournament because of how it was. Azari is a very good bowler. Yet still he's still learning. He's very young. There's a lot of positives still for St. Kitts and Nevis Patriots. Hopefully these guys are around for a lot longer and we can see their true potential.
Tough luck again today. You are exceptional as an individual and all the very best to you.
Thanks, man. Thanks.
And as a follow-up to the visit and commitment made by His Excellency President Irfan Ali, the Minister of Culture, Youth and Sport, Charles Ramson Jr., on Saturday visited the community of Tiger Bay in Georgetown. The minister was accompanied by the National Security Advisor, Gerald Gavaya, President of the Guyana Football Federation, Wayne Ford, President of the Guyana Basketball Federation, Michael Singh, President of the Georgetown Amateur Basketball Association, Jermaine Slater, and members of the private sector. During the visit, the team distributed footballs, basketballs, other sport gear, and masks to aid in the containing of the spread of COVID-19 within the community. In addition, the minister discussed with the community the possibility of clearing an area for sport to be played. The team also used the opportunity to engage with the community and listen to some of the major issues affecting them. Now, as the West Indies women settle in England ahead of their 5-match T20 series against the host nation, fast bowler Shamelia Cannell has been talking to West Indies media about how the Caribbean side has been coping with training in a bubble.
Welcome back to another edition of the Maroon Capsule with the West Indies women here in Derby in the UK. Today, we're joined by Shamelia Cannell, fast bowler of the West Indies women. Shamelia Cannell, we've been here in the UK in Derby just about a week now. Living in a bubble, how has it been so far living in the bubble?
Life in the bubble has been good, you know. We've been a family for a while now, so, you know, we're just trying to keep the vibes going within the team and stuff like that. So it hasn't been that hard. We just enjoying each other's company, you know, and just going with it as the day goes.
What are you doing to occupy yourself in this time? Because, I mean, other than training, there is no going out of the bubble. How have you been occupying yourself?
You know, we've been playing some games in the team games room. We've been coming together. We're having some daily conversation, me and my friends, you know, so it's been good.
What did you bring on tour to keep yourself occupied?
A couple of cards and a book to read.
Yeah, and in terms of the provisions that the ECB have provided for us here in Derby, how has it been? I mean, we have a games room, etc. How have you all been utilizing it?
Everyone's been utilizing the games room and stuff like that. You know, the food has been getting better and better. You know, we're having some salmon, some jerk chicken. You know, it's a bit of like Caribbean style mixed with the English thing, and we just having some fun.
Looking forward to the series, of course.
Of course. First series for the women's cricket back out, we're looking to bring the game.
And with that, we've come to the end of the news for this evening. Of course, you can find updates on these and other stories on our website, newsroom.gy, our Facebook page and Instagram. On behalf of the entire news team, I'm Avinash Ramzan. Thanks for watching. Be safe. See you next time.